Okay. So, this one is going to be similar to another video I did months back. This is going to be going over multi-class options for a particular party and the way that will affect that party and the various characters within the party. And tonight, it's like 4:30 when I'm recording this. The party I'm going to be looking at is the party from my Curse of Strahd game on Monday nights. So, thing about this party, one of the players is playing two characters. So, it's a five-player group, six-character group. It's not super unheard of. I've heard of other of people playing multiple characters, and it doesn't seem particularly difficult as long as you design the characters in a certain way. Personality-wise, I mean. So, first, I'll go over the characters again in case whoever you are watching this isn't familiar with the group or hasn't watched any of my other videos where I discuss this group. What the hell is this? What the hell is that? Asphalt muncher machine. Anyway, so in this group, my character is Senlir, the Aesimar Zealot Barbarian. Next character, Wanderer, a reborn death cleric. Etsli, the Yuan-T Hexblade Warlock. Unta, the Goblin Shepherd Druid. Alosrin, the Vedalkin Evocation Wizard, I believe. And finally, the last character to join us, the one that just joined us very recently, last session, Stormhorn, the Minotaur Storm Herald Barbarian. So, first, the first two characters I want to touch on are Senlir and Wanderer. Both me and Wanderer's player have both kind of come to the same conclusion that these two characters are going to go straight single class the whole way. They're not multi-classing in anything else. There's no real need. And the track that they're on is more than interesting enough. And I'll circle around to Senlir, to my character, when I talk about Stormhorn later on. Because barbarians are an interesting topic when it comes to multi-classing. But next we have Etsli, the Hexblade Warlock. So, Hexblade multi-classes fantastically with so many things. There's the classic multi-classing into Paladin to get access to, you know, depending on exactly how you want to do it. If you want to mainly play a Paladin and just dip into Hexblade for one single level to get that sweet charisma to attack and damage rolls, you can always do that. But Etsli is a level 6 warlock currently. So I think level 6 is... I have to look at the warlock with class progression again. God, man, this friggin' mount is not fantastic. But at some point, they could multi-class into Paladin, start getting Paladin features, get more spell slots that are, you know, the normal kind of thing. Eventually, Etsli would get extra attack from Paladin level 5, Paladin auras, which with the 20 charisma that Etsli has would be amazing. But it wouldn't offer a huge amount of variety or real extra things for Etsli's playstyle. Right now, they're the versatile character in the group. They can hang back and sling Eldritch Blasts. They can get up in the front line and mix it up. But, you know, they're not super specialized, and they're very, very versatile. Going Paladin doesn't really help that out too much. You'd get some unique spells, and you'd get Smite, But that just focuses you in more on melee combat. Doesn't do anything for when you're attacking with Eldritch Blast, but you could argue that you don't need anything there. But also, if you do get extra attack from Paladin, then that allows you to make, obviously, two weapon attacks, and you don't have to rely on the bonus action that Etsley's currently relying on to do double Green Flame Blade, because this character got the Bracers of Illusion, if anybody knows what that is. Ah, my ear hurts. Okay. So that would be an okay multi-class. Probably not super interesting. And it'd be more interesting for the different paladin auras that Etsley could get. Another really good multi-class would be either sorcerer or barbarian. Sorcerer or bard, not barbarian. We don't need more barbarian in the party. So with sorcerer or bard, you get the same kind of spell slot progression, charisma casting. But they do a few different things. One, I think Bard is probably a weaker choice. Yeah, Bard is probably a weaker choice because Etsley is going to be so bonus action reliant because of the Bracers of Illusion that they don't get too many opportunities to really throw out Bardic Inspirations and not miss doing a bunch of damage. But it's an idea. You know, especially, that would require a certain kind of narrative flavor, how Etsley starts doing Bardic magic instead, or in addition to their pack magic. Sorcerer is a lot more digestible, I'm going to say. It makes a lot more sense. It's similar enough to the magic they're already doing, and there's lots of different ways you can explain it. And what Sorcerer lets you do is, of course, just like Bard, have a much more normal spell slot progression. You get, you know, you get two or three first level, I think it's three, first level slots literally right away, as soon as you dip into that. And then you get new spell slots almost every level. And maybe you don't have to go too far into this. Maybe you just go, Etsley could go into Sorcerer for like, you know, 4 or 5 levels just to get, maybe, actually I'd probably say 6 levels, because that's where you get an optional feature for Sorcerers, where you can spend a Sorcery point to basically, to re-roll a d20. That's a nice little feature to have, and you'd only have 6 Sorcery points per day at that point, but that, of course, multi-classes with Warlock really well. Anytime you take a short rest, you can convert any Warlock packed slots that you currently have into Sorcery points, and then just have those Sorcery points for the rest of the day. You can always... So, if you haven't used your slots, you can always kind of refresh your sorcery points and kind of get those back. And it works pretty well. That's the basis of what's called the coffee lock, if you're familiar with that concept. But in just normal, like a normal kind of character, where you're not trying to like game the system using this technique, it's pretty good. It's pretty cool. You get access to sorcerer spells, you can throw some fireballs. Of course, if you were to multi-class now, at level 6, you wouldn't get fireball until friggin' level 10, 11, yeah, 11. And at that point, the Evocation Wizard has 5th level spell slots, but fireball's always going to be good. So, that's kind of it for Etsley. They could, if they were going to go Bard, they could go Swords Bard to get extra attack and something, but eh. They could theoretically go Bladesinger Wizard to get the weird extra attack with cantrip thing, and then make one weapon attack, make a cantrip Green Flame Blade, and then do their bonus action green flame blade. But that's like some shenanigans. But you get wizard spells. It's kind of good. It's kind of good. Yeah. That's mostly it for Etsley. Unta is another one that's probably going to stay straight druid the whole way. Though there's plenty of multi-classes that could work. A lot of different cleric builds or cleric dips could work, or just cleric multi-classes. Of course, you don't want to split up your spell progression too much, because then you miss out on higher level spells. But certain cleric, like a level 2 cleric dip, could be more than fine. You pick up some cantrips, a few, you can grab all cleric first level spells, just things like bless, all that good stuff. But you could also just get bless from a feat. You get armor, but I don't know how much Unta cares about getting heavy armor, for example. It's a 1-level dipping cleric, not level 2, not 2-level. That's where they get 2-level? That's where they get their subclass at level 1. Anyway. You know, all those are fine. There's not a lot of reason to dip martially for Unta. Like, you know, Unta could dip into barbarian, but that doesn't make a lot of sense. Not getting a whole lot for that, especially because Unta is the more healer-focused character. Maybe a warlock dip could be interesting. I don't know how much charisma. Oh, that was another thing. Dipping back to Etsley real quick. Paladin would be a great multiclass, but per the normal rules, Etsley doesn't have enough strength to multiclass into Paladin, which is sometimes a thing that gets waived by the DM, and they don't really care that much. But anyway, returning to Unta, a warlock dip could be cool because there's some exclusive warlock spells that are always fun. Things like Armor of Agathys. All that interesting stuff. Which, you know, you can cast with your druid slots. There's no real reason you can't. Man, traffic is weird right now. Yeah, cast it with your druid slots. Like, put up Armor of Agathys at, like, 5th level. And then friggin' wild shape into a cat, and you've got 25 temporary hit points. It'd be cool. You could do it. But for Unta's role, the only thing that would really help out is like a dip into life cleric to get the extra healing, but it's not super necessary. A Losrin. Probably, I'm betting that the player is just going to keep a Losrin a straight evocation wizard. No need to get fancy, especially because Alosrin is kind of the secondary character for this player. Their main character is Unta. And Alosrin is just kind of there to be like, hey, I have high intelligence. I can read. And I can do fireballs. That's basically what Alosrin does. So, multi-class into like Artificer could be fun. Like, take 3 levels in Artificer, grab Artillerist or Battlesmith, and then just have a bonus action you can do. Put the cannon down, and Alosrin can just do some extra things, because Alosrin doesn't really do much with his bonus action right now. That's a big reason to multiclass. Bonus action utilization. Of which, for all these characters I've mentioned so far, no, there's Etsley always uses their bonus action. Unta does occasionally, I think, for like a healing word. And Wanderer uses his bonus action all the time. But Alosrin doesn't. So a dip into Artificer could be really good. All you need is just those 3 levels. Get the cannon, and it'll do okay damage. It'll do a 2d8. It'll be fine. Or you can have it as the protector cannon and have it sit on like Stormhorn's back and just give everybody around in the front lines constant temporary hit points. That'd be cool. That'd be a thing to do. But moving on to Stormhorn. I think this character is the one that's more ripe for multiclassing. So there's a few reasons for that. One, I fully admit this is kind of a selfish perspective. We already have a barbarian in the party that's going to be barbarian all the way through. So there'd be reason enough to differentiate there. And the only reason Senlir would dip into anything else, he could take a few levels of monk. And the main thing that would do is get him a bonus action attack. That'd be the main reason to do that, which is kind of boring. And a big, big cost, because the Barbarian Capstone at level 20 is fantastic. Problem is, with Barbarians in general, is after about level 8, 9, once you start getting the brutal critical features, they don't get a lot of interesting things. They get all the same, all normal ASIs and stuff, but they get brutal critical, they get relentless rage, which lets them avoid dropping to zero hit points with a DC, you know, so they can sometimes survive, which on occasion, barbarians, especially at that level, they're not always going to be dropping to zero hit points anyway. Enemies, monsters and stuff are usually going to be going after the weaker, more squishy characters. So, a lot of the time, the barbarian isn't actually going to get attacked, even though they have the highest hit points. But that's contextual. Then a few levels, they get more brutal criticals. They get persistent rage, which lets them avoid the normal rage dropping conditions where, you know, if you don't hit anybody for a turn, you drop rage, that kind of thing. So you don't have to worry about that anymore. Then you get some other little minor stuff, and you get subclass features all the way. But another aspect of barbarians is that after the second subclass feature you get at level 6, a lot of subclasses have really boring features for the level 13, I think it is. No, the level 10 and the level 14 feature that they offer. And that's one of the reasons that Senlir is staying barbarian the whole way, is because Zealot actually gets two really interesting features for level 10 and for level 14. At level 10, they get the ability to do this, like, divine shout, and it gives all their allies advantage on attack rolls for a round. For a bit. That's really fun. That's really cool. It can support the group, whereas a lot of other classes or subclasses kind of gets... I'm backing in. Gearbox stuck. Whereas a lot of other subclasses for Barbarian at level 10 and 14, they don't give a whole lot. Oh, and Zealot at level 14, it lets you just straight up not die. That's why it's fun. But classes like Storm, or subclasses like Storm Herald, Berserker, even like, you know, the fan favorite, the Totem Barbarian, those higher level features aren't that interesting. And the base class is also doesn't have a whole lot to keep you there. Whereas, like, you know, around level 9, 10, a lot of players will start to look at other classes like, oh, I could pick up Fighter, and I can get a Fighting Style, I can get Action Surge, I can then get, or like, you know, like, oh, I'll take one level in Fighter. Oh, cool, I got a Fighting Style, I got Second Wind, those are nice, they're fun. Little, you know, I can get, like, mechanical bonus, and I can get this thing to heal me sometimes, because I don't use my bonus action all the time, which a lot of barbarians don't. Storm Herald does. That limits multi-classing. So, that's a thing. Then, if I could go back to barbarian, or, oh, I could take another level in fighter and get Action Surge, the best feature in the game. oh god, I could take a third level and get, you know, a subclass, and Fighter has tons of great subclasses, including things like Samurai, which lets you use your bonus action to just get advantage for a round without having to use Reckless Attack, so you have that option to still get advantage whenever on demand, but you don't have to incur advantage on attacks against you. And for Stormhorn, that's particularly tricky, because the Storm Herald Barbarian uses your bonus action every turn to use its class feature, like Lightning Strikes or Fire Auras or the temporary hit point thing from the Tundra variation. So that limits things. And normally I would say, like, oh yeah, it'd be super cool to have a Minotaur Barbarian that multiclasses in the Monk, so he can hit people with his horns and do martial arts while he's using his axe. That'd be super fun. But if you're going to use your Storm Herald stuff, you can't do that, because you're already using your bonus action. So you can't do that. That's like, for me, that almost be like, I want to switch my subclass to something else that doesn't use my bonus action. But that's just me. Otherwise, you can look at classes that don't use your bonus action. Something like Paladin. That'd be super great for a Barbarian. While you're raging, of course, you can't cast spells. But if you're using all your spell slots for Smite anyway, what's the fucking difference? Smite isn't a spell. You can do it while raging. Who gives a shit? Fighter's great. Ranger is interesting. Because, sure, while you can't cast spells while you're raging, depending on the Ranger subclass you pick up, you can use spell slots to do other things. Granted, say if you're going to pick up, say, Drake Warden and get the Dragon Companion. Well, it uses your bonus action, so you can't use that, can you? Gloomstalker's great. Hunter's always decent. But the main thing there is a lot of Ranger spells are utility. They're not necessarily in-combat spells. So you get that out-of-combat utility that Ranger offers. That'd be a super cool multi-class, and I think that would also fit really well with Stormhorn's flavor. You pick up Druid, I guess, but you know, same kind of thing. You just get more spell slots, whereas Ranger at least gives you fighting styles and some other cool stuff. But yeah, it's mainly, one of the main things going on there is that Barbarians after level 9 get a little thin, and you start to feel like you're not getting as much. So a lot of players will start to multi-class out, which means you'll never get that level 20 capstone feature for Barbarians where their strength and constitution increase by 4 each and increases the cap of each to 24. Like, at that point, Senlir has this belt of fire giant strength, which sets his strength to 25. But once he gets to level 20, he won't need that belt anymore. So that'll be cool, because 24 and 25 strength, as far as most mechanics are concerned, are the same number, because the modifier for either one is +7. But yeah, that was just a quick little talk about multi-classing for my Curse of Strahd party.